not done justice, he will fail. But the very fact that he has done justice doesn't mean that he is going to be expert.
Yes, chances.
Expert. Expert has to, yeah. So, next. Yep. So, and the another thing is cryptography, which is, the classic case is BlackBerry. Now, what is a BlackBerry case? It's that you just create a message in BlackBerry and send it across to somebody else. BlackBerry itself will convert it into a cryptographic message. So that, and it will be saved in the BlackBerry server only, which is in Canada, which doesn't come under the purview of Indian jurisdiction. So, and that private company doesn't allow any other company or any other country to have access on that. See, here try rules and regulations permit police to have direct access to BSNL's computer or Tata Telecom's computer or Idea Mobile's computer. Direct access.
Is it?
Yes.
Without the service providers?
Who on service providers this thing?
Because not legal. That's not legal.
Service provider has to provide all the data
compulsorily.
Idea wants license, Idea has to sign that.
Yeah. That is true, but the ID Act, like, now they are coming up with certain guidelines, rules which are coming before. But privacy regulations, there is a committee, just like telephone interception, there is a committee which has to certify and authorize. It can be done only 60 days, I think 120 days at a time, I think it's longer than all those things. But obviously the software will be illegal.
We don't want 120 days, we just want only 120 minutes of access to get all the details, history. Right, so just 120 minutes of access will do. To access the, to get all the details of all his usage for the past 3 years or 4 years or 5 years. Secret steganography, which is another very interesting thing. For example, police have, say, me and Giridhar are under the monitor of police. They suspect that we are anti-national people. So, all messages between we two are being traced. But actually, we are suppose anti-national criminals. And I go to send some message to Giridhar. What I do is, I know that I'm being monitored by police. So, what we can do is, I can take this photograph. Common friend. He's a friend of Giridhar, he's my friend also. I can take this photograph and I can put this message behind the photograph. And then send it. Whoever gets this photograph, they click on that. Photograph will be displayed. Oh, whose photograph? Oh, this gentleman. How was he connected to Vinod? Police can prove that he is a friend of Vinod. Police can prove that he is a friend of Vinod. No problem. Very, very, what is it? Natural thing. It's a natural thing. There's no secret listing involved. It's not a secret message. But Giridhar knows how to take the secret message out of that photograph.
Because you have trained him earlier.
Trained. Giridhar is trained, I am also trained.
Okay.
This is steganography. Now, this is actually widely used by Indian defense or any defense in the world.
War technique.
It's a war technique, but it's being misused by anti-national people.
Correct. Terrorists are
used. Terrorists, particularly terrorists.
It is misused in war and also misused outside.
Yeah.
Why do you think war is used?
AC is on.
If it's on, you want it
on? I feel that it's a bit hot inside. Okay, now next. Same steganographic or cryptographic techniques are used in satellite phones also. Same techniques are used. Still abuse satellite phones. Next. Abusing digital signature. Digital signature, everybody knows PKI.
Yeah, yeah.
The thing. You can abuse that because, see, for example, in digital signature, there are two codes. Everybody knows that. How digital signature works. Now, you think that nobody can break into
two layers, no? Two layers, isn't it? Is that what you think?
Basically, what a user gets is a set of two codes. Right? Now, the public key and the private key.
Ah, okay, that's key.
Two keys. Now, user is worried only about two keys, right? Now, suppose you have created your letter using the public key and signed it using the private key, send it across to me along with the public key. I use a public key to open your file, letter and see this, right? But I can't edit that. Unless I have the private key, I can't edit that. So it's as if you have signed this letter.
Read only.
Read only. I can't edit that. I can't, all those things. Now, so all these things, under the belief that this cannot be abused, tampered. But there are techniques to abuse that.
So we have belief.
It's only a belief. Next. That is storage. Another thing, hard disk. There are plenty of crimes that have been used by abusing the abusing file slacks, as I have explained, file slacking, abusing swap files. You know what a swap file is, right? Suppose you have only 4 GB RAM in your computer, but there are applications which require 5 GB. So what about that additional 1 GB? Who will give you additional 1 GB? You will, without your knowledge, computer itself will create additional 1 GB in the hard disk. Because that 4 GB RAM means it is electronic memory. Hard disk is different. Electronic memory is different. 4 GB RAM. Now suppose you click on some application that require 5 GB. Computer itself will create additional 1 GB by taking a small portion, 1 GB portion from the hard disk. And this extra thing will be stored in that space. And computer will somehow
jumble
and then get it done. But when you switch on the computer, whatever is there in the RAM will be lost, right? But that additional thing in the hard disk will not be lost. So the criminal, if any criminal has done something, he has taken care not to store it in the hard disk. He has taken care not to store anything in that hard disk. He has saved only in that pen drive. And he has taken away the pen drive. Yeah. So he is under belief that nothing is there in the hard disk. But this swap file is there, and all his criminal, or part of his criminal activities
will lie there.
Will lie there.
Residue.
Huh?
Residue.
Yeah, residue. So we go there to find out the evidence. Swap file. So abuse of database. All financial frauds are being traced using database forensic techniques. There are software packages available, there are forensic techniques available, there are commands available, there are so many things available to help us to take financial fraud data. Say for example, financial fraud can be established only by taking evidence of manipulations, actual editing of cash book, actual editing of journal, actual editing of ledger, those things. So you need when, what, who, all these things are to be answered on each and every manipulation of each and every debit or credit. All these things can be proved with the help of database forensic techniques. Next. Now, even again, let me say, reformatting will not destroy the data. Yeah. Now, this is evident. Have you ever noticed you have an 80 GB hard disk? You are using that. You reformat it. Suddenly you find that only you have only 78 GB. 72 GB. What about the remaining 8 GB? 8 GB, that is used for storing the old data. Old data files are there. Now we are interested in the remaining 8 GB.
Where did it go?
No, it's there. It's there.
We are not bothered about 72.
We are bothered about that 8 GB. In 8 GB, we have all the evidence of the
footprints.
Exactly.
But while reformatting it, whether we can 100% delete the file.
That's what I said. We can't.
It is not possible.
It's not.
With your help also.
No. There is one thing called low level formatting.
We were doing some
he has some cases for you if you can.
I'll tell you. See, the best technique available in the world is called low level formatting. to reformat the hard disk is low level formatting. It has been there since
2018.
Better and better techniques are available to for low level formatting. They say it can never be traced. Still, I say it can be traced.
That's why you talked about subcutaneous memory, isn't it? So you talked about subcutaneous memory of the hard disk, which is always present. Mm-hmm.
This is 8 GB.
This is the subcutaneous memory.
That's what. Okay, next. So facing all these things like deleted data, data diddling is like, for example, in big companies, there are cases like, say, suppose my basic salary is 32,000 rupees. Just before salary processing, I can change to 38,000 rupees. And then process salary and then
put it back to
32,000 rupees.
We get our account again 32.
If you can use database forensic techniques, I can prove that on this day, this time, from 32 to 38, and on this day, this time back. In between, police can very well prove that, I can give the salary processing date, time, everything also, that
matters.
And who has done that? Username also, everything can be given. Username also, so in identification of culprit. Suppose, I am the user, I have done that, but not me, I have asked you to do that from your computer using my username and password. So, with the help of username and password, police can trace me.
But in that computer, nothing will be there.
And data also belong to me, but police will trace back to his computer. So, police will have to prove that I am the culprit and not him. I got a case of that also, and I proved that the actual thing was done by the database administrator.
System administrator
himself has done with the help of somebody else's username and password. So we traced back to the particular user, and we proved that he has not done the thing, but the system admin has done the thing. This gives lot of challenges.
Please.
Unauthorized access, like you know that. Remote manipulation of doctor's prescription to kill the patient.